Thank you for joining us for the Protocol Labs Research Seminar Series. Today's speaker is João Leitão. João is an assistant professor in the informatics department at the University of Lisbon and an integrated member of the NOVA Laboratory for Computer Science and Informatics. His research is in the context of computer systems group, focusing on the scalability and dependability of large-scale distributed systems, with an additional focus on cloud computing environments, particularly in geo-distributed settings, and also peer-to-peer systems. So I will leave the intro at that, even though there's a lot of other cool stuff that he is working on, and I'll turn it over to you for the talk.
Okay, thank you, Jonathan, for the introduction. So the talk today will be about topology management and gossip, and how these are, in my perspective, ways to scale systems, okay? So this is the structure for the talk. I'm actually repeating a bit the introduction of Jonathan to give you a bit more detail of who I am. Then I'll give you a bit of context on the talk regarding peer-to-peer systems and overlay networks. I will discuss a few different mechanisms to manage the topology of overlay networks, which is the main focus of the talk. And then I will conclude with some future directions and things that are still not solved regarding the subject. So as Jonathan said, my name is João Leitão. I have a PhD in computer engineering, information systems computer engineering from the Technical University of Lisbon here in Portugal. My interests in research are distributed systems at large, okay? But I've been working over the years on peer-to-peer, then cloud computing, then edge computing, and a mix of all of these topics. And hopefully by the end of the talk, you'll understand that there is some points of contact here. And just to summarize what I'm trying to do with my research is trying to make distributed systems scale to new sizes and while ensuring that these systems can still be efficient and robust. And when I say robustness here, I mean like tolerant to failures, both on the network and on individual components of the system. So I work in Portugal, which if you don't know, it's a small country in one of the corners of Europe, okay? In particular, I'm in Lisbon, which is a very nice city. And I hope that if you never were here, you should try to when this pandemic goes away, finally. As Jonathan said, I'm an assistant professor at the computer science department or informatics department, if you use the European terminology, at the NOVA School for Science and Technology from the NOVA University of Lisbon. And I do my research with this amazing bunch of people that are in the computer systems groups in our laboratory, in other words. And if you want to get some personal information about me, well, I have two cats, okay? It's Tigre and Artemis, and they are doing what they are probably doing now in this photo, which is sleeping, lucky. Okay, so the topic of this talk will be peer-to-peer systems, okay? And this is a very close topic to me because I worked for several years in peer-to-peer systems. So obviously, most of what I'm going to say is my personal take and my personal view of this field. So you might ask yourself, why am I thinking about peer-to-peer systems? This has been around from the early 2000s, okay? And the reason mainly is because these systems over the years have tackled many of the challenges that we still face nowadays to scale systems large sizes, okay? And they were used to support large variety of different services like file sharing, distributed backups, virtual currency. If you think like Bitcoin is actually on top of peer-to-peer technology. And I believe that they are increasingly relevant nowadays, okay? In part because of edge computing, and I will get back to that in the end of the talk. And also because there are some practical solutions appearing every day, and some of which came from protocol labs like IPFS, but I'm thinking about the P2P Lib and Filecoin that they recently launched. So while the talk is about peer-to-peer systems, I'm going to focus on topology management for overlay networks and gossip protocols, which I think are fundamental mechanisms that emerged from this community and that they are still nowadays quite relevant to make systems scale. And when I said that I want to make a system scale, well, there are many factors that we have to consider if we want systems to really scale, okay? It's not a trivial question. But I think there are a set of ingredients that are always essential. And I think these were quite prominent in peer-to-peer systems. And the first is to ensure that your system can support decentralized operation, that you do not depend highly, at least, on centralized components that can fail or can become unavailable due to network partitions. And the other thing is that the components of your system, they should have a load that increases slowly as the system scales, okay, as you add more components into the system. So fundamentally, these are decentralized operation and load distribution. And what I'm going to focus on do always have these properties in mind, okay? And if you want to really understand where I'm trying to go, we do have to consider some architecture for a peer-to-peer system. And I remind you, this is a very personal and very simplified view of what a peer-to-peer system is. And due to my background, I tend to see things as layered, okay? One on top of the other, okay? So I see all of these systems in a very simplistic way as having these four layers. There's the network, an overlay network, some peer-to-peer service or protocol, and then the distributed application on top of it. So let me go quickly over what I'm assuming about each of these components. So the network, as I usually say to my students, it's not your friend, right? The network, it's an essential component. It will allow your components to exchange information and exchange messages, and this is essential, okay, to build a distributed system. Usually when we think about the network, we're thinking about some IP network, okay? But the network is there basically to mess your life up, okay? So it's going to lead to message losses, you can have network partitions, and you have to deal with all of these aspects, evidently. We usually assume in peer-to-peer systems that every process or every node in the system can send messages to any other node, and that is in general true, okay? Although in some cases, there are firewalls and NAT boxes, if you think about systems that run on user devices, that might restrict this model and make it impossible for peers to communicate with each other. I'm not going to tackle this issue in this talk because there are some previous work that has tried to mitigate this effect. And so, and nowadays we have Stun and Turn, which basically allows us to circumvent these issues more or less in a straightforward way. Okay? Another component that I think is much more interesting are overlay networks, okay? So many of the peer-to-peer systems operating in the past and nowadays, they have to operate on top of some logical network that is overlaid, meaning on top of the physical network, the IP network that I just mentioned, okay? And these overlays are basically at the foundation of many of these systems. And what I argue here, okay, is that the properties of these overlays, and in particular, the topology of the overlays, is quite relevant to how the system behaves as a whole, okay? And in fact, there are different types of overlays that provide different abstractions to the layers that sit above it, okay? The peer-to-peer services and applications, okay? So just to remind you, in a nutshell, the overlays are defined by having each node in the system. We have a set of neighbors, okay, by neighboring relationships that are defined among these nodes. And depending on the properties of the overlay, you can classify them broadly in two main groups, which are unstructured and structured, okay? Unstructured overlays, also called random, are basically networks that have no given property on the topology, so just nodes will connect to each other at random, okay? And they will operate on top of this random topology. And as you will see, this is enough to solve many problems in peer-to-peer systems. On the other side of the spectrum, we have structured overlays for which the most well-known cases are DHTs, where you have a fixed topology that is known a priori, typically based on some property of the nodes, like the identifier. And you can take advantage of that topology to do more sophisticated stuff, like application level routing, distributing keys over a set of nodes, using consistent hashing, all of that. Okay? And when you compare the different properties of these different overlays, you actually see that they sort of complement each other. So for the unstructured side, since they are random, they are very easy to build and to manage. They have actually a very low cost for doing that in terms of communication. And since they don't have to enforce any restriction on their topology, on the neighboring relationships, they tend to be very robust to failures. So whenever a node fails, it's very easy to find a replacement node and ensure that their overlay is still correct. But as you can imagine, they have limited functionality. They've been mostly used to broadcast information and things like that. If you want to do more sophisticated operations on top of it, you might incur in high cost. Like you might need to flood the overlay to find something if you are looking for, imagine a block of a file in the network. Structured overlays are quite the opposite. So since they have all of these restrictions imposed on their topology, to be correct, they tend to have a high management cost in terms of communication. And it has been shown in the past that at least for classical designs like CORD, that if you have lots of nodes failing at the same time, or you have churn, which is a phenomenon where nodes go in and outside of the system at the same time, so you have high turnover of nodes in the system, then the overlay might break. Okay? And if the overlay breaks, then all of the functionality that it can provide to you is lost. On the other hand, when the overlay is correct, it has more functionality. You can do all of those things like application level routing, which is quite nice. Okay? So this serves to point to you that the topology of these overlays is really important. Okay, so they will not only affect the performance of your system, depending on what are the underlying properties of the network that you build, but even the topology that the network has will affect the abstractions that you can easily build on top of them. Okay, and so this is quite an important point that I will evidently go back further ahead. So moving on my architecture, we then have peer-to-peer services. And this is a layer where I basically put distributed algorithms, many times using gossip, that provide some abstraction to applications, okay? And these abstractions can be things like providing broadcast primitives, resource location primitives, synchronization primitives. There are lots of mechanisms and services that you can build on top of an overlay network. And this makes the life easier for the programmers of distributed applications, because then they don't have to go and re-implement all of these abstractions over and over again. They can simply use the ones that you already have available. And again, just to provide you an example, some of the services that you can build here can be resource location services that provide you the ability to find a particular file in the network, or some information management system that allows you to broadcast control information throughout your system, for instance, to manipulate the configuration of the system as a whole. And finally, before going to the applications, let me discuss a bit about the gossip protocols that are usually underlying the operation of these services, okay? So as I said, many of these services use gossip protocols, and there's no easy definition for a gossip protocol. I will just say that it's a protocol that is highly decentralized, and it usually allows processes in a system to share information among them in a mostly uncoordinated fashion, typically by having pairwise independent exchanges of messages, okay? To give you a concrete example, you can think about an epidemic broadcast protocol, which basically serves to broadcast messages in the network. And I will use this service in particular throughout the rest of the talk, which is quite very simple, okay? So if a node wants to broadcast a message, it just has to pick a given number of processes from its underlying overlay. I'll say T, which is a common parameter called fanout, and it sends a message to those processes. And then whenever a process receives a message for the first time, it just repeats this process. It picks T random peers from the overlay that is underlying the service and sends a message to them. And what the mathematics and the theory of epidemics that nowadays it's actually well known for completely different reasons says is that if your fanout is at least on the order of the natural logarithm of the total number of processes in your system, then there is a very high probability that everyone will get the message, even if there are independent failures of nodes or messages get lost. And in fact, this is just one of the possibility for a gossip protocol and a peer-to-peer service, if you want, because as my colleague and Marie Carmarek would say, there are 1,001 flavors of gossip. Okay? You can build very different protocols depending on how you make some choices about the operation of your gossip protocol. So you can decide when you contact peers, should you do it periodically? Should you do it when you have new information? What is the fanout that you use? Is it one? Is it the logarithm of the total number of nodes? Is it every neighbors that you have, okay? And depending on these selections, you will end up with protocols that actually in the literature have different names, like Hummer-Morsvik, epidemic broadcast, and the entropy, random walks, all of that. Again, in this talk, I'll focus on Epidemic Broadcast because it's a very simple service that is easy to grasp. So maybe a thing that is not obvious here, but that is important to notice is that the operation of these gossip protocols and these peer-to-peer services are actually not completely decoupled from the overlay topology. Some of these variants of gossip do require the overlay to provide some special properties on the neighbors that it exposes, right? And in some cases, the performance that you get by running these services might be quite different depending on what is it that is the overlay topology that you have, right? Like, for instance, in Epidemic Broadcast, your broadcast might be faster or slower or more robust to failures or less robust to failures, depending on what is the overlay that you have running underlying. And we'll get back to that later on. And finally, in regards to the distributed application, I will not get into many details, okay? So this is basically the system that we are building, looking at this architecture. It will take advantage of everything that is below it, any number of peer-to-peer services, maybe more than one overlay network. It can, as I said before, be different types of applications like distributed backup, monitoring, data dissemination, et cetera. And if your underlying abstractions are good, if your peer-to-peer services implementations are good and your topology, your overlay topology is adequate to what we're doing, these systems might work perfectly and be amazing. Well, if you don't have the right abstractions, then things can be a bit messy, okay? For instance, in Bitcoin, they do have an overlay network, which is a bit messy. And it is my belief, and some of my colleagues also, that this actually makes the Bitcoin protocol a bit more expensive in terms of communication that it needed to be, okay? So just to summarize the motivation here, peer-to-peer architectures are a very good starting point to build centralized and scalable distributed applications, still nowadays. A key component of these systems are overlay networks that provide an important abstraction for building any protocol or application on top of it. These overlays, ironically, are also managed typically by using gossip exchanges, okay? And the services that operate on top of these overlays can provide very powerful abstractions to applications, but these abstractions might really depend on the overlay that you're running and the topology of that overlay. So these are the key points that you should keep in mind. And please, I didn't say this in the start, but if you have questions, go ahead and just ask your questions. Don't wait for the end. You don't need to. So now that I tried to convince you that the topology of these overlays is important, what is it that we can do here to improve these topologies, okay? So there are several techniques, evidently. What I'm going to discuss during the remainder of this talk is actually a particular family of techniques where you depart from unstructured overlays and you add some additional restrictions to the topology of your random overlay such that you get closer to a structured overlay, but not really getting completely there. So the solutions that I'm going to show you are not going to allow you to do application level routing like a DHT, but they will have some impact, measurable impact on the performance of any protocol or system that you run on top of it. So you'll get something that is not completely unstructured, but also not structured. So if you need to give it a name for convenience, let's just call it a partially structured overlay. Okay. And in fact, what we discovered over the years is that there are very different ways to do this that I just described now, okay? From picking up a random overlay and then add some properties to get more efficiency or more properties out of it. And these solutions can operate at different levels of the stack, okay? So at the overlay network, you can do something that I call control. And control basically is a technique where you actively impose restrictions on the neighboring relationships of nodes while you create the overlay network. But you can also do bias. And bias is a different technique where you allow the overlay to be random as a starting point, but then iteratively you start switching some links to improve the topology given some criteria that is important for your service or for your application. Surprisingly, maybe you can also do this at the peer-to-peer service level, okay? And one way that we can do that is by taking into consideration the feedback that you get from the operation of the service. And you can do something that I call embed, which is basically defining a secondary topology that is on top of the original random overlay that is maintained just for that service. And that will allow that service to have a better performance. And finally, you have another technique, which is which I call enrich, where you again take in consideration the feedback from the operation of the service, and you just add some additional links to your overlay at the service level that will allow your service to have more efficient communication patterns. In this talk, there are several different protocols in the literature that explore these different alternatives, but maybe important, in this talk, I will only touch on these three, okay? So I will only discuss the control, bias, and embed solutions, giving as case studies the Hyper-V protocol, the XBOT protocol, and the telemetry protocol. So let's start with Hyper-V. So when we designed Hyper-V, actually, what we were trying to do was to devise an unstructured overlay network whose properties were specially tailored to support efficient epidemic broadcasts. And by efficient here, I mean that it should spend the minimal amount of messages possible to achieve high probability that every process gets the message. And we are also focused on ensuring that our solution would support failures, and in particular catastrophic failures, where a large fraction of the nodes can fail simultaneously. Okay? And our work starts with a simple observation. Okay, so if you have a set of processes, which in my diagrams are always blue circles, and you have some random overlay connecting them, even if the number of neighbors that you have for each node is lower than the natural logarithm of the total number of processes, as the epidemic theory would impose, and if you just want to broadcast a message, imagine that the red node wants to broadcast a message, as long as the overlay is connected, it is sufficient to flood the message throughout every link in the overlay, even if the number of links, again, is below the natural logarithm of the total number of processes. This might seem to contradict the epidemic theory, but actually, it's not necessarily so, okay? It's important just to ensure that the overlay remains connected at all times. So this was sort of the first observation that led to the design of Hyper-V, which explores this notion of controlling the topology at creation time. The thing is that if you want to flood the network, you must make sure for efficiency that you have a very small number of neighbors. Otherwise, the cost for communication for each process will be too high, okay? And you might overload the network in some cases. On the other hand, a small number of neighbors makes the overlay very, very susceptible to break if some processes crash, because each process knows a small number of neighbors. If all of those neighbors crash, which might be a small fraction, then that node becomes disconnected. So there was this tension here. And what we did in Hyper-V was basically to do something different from what other protocols have, and there are lots of protocols to build unstructured overlays, which is to have two sets of neighbors that are independent and used for different purposes. The first set is a very small one, and this is managed reactively, meaning that we only update the contents of that neighbor set when we really need to, either because some node joined the overlay or we detected some failure. And here is in this set of neighbors is where we apply the control approach, where we enforce an additional property to this set of neighbors, which is actually for them to be symmetric. So if node A is neighbor of B, B must be neighbor of A. That's a small, very small control enforcement that we make, but it actually has a lot of impact in the end. And then we have a second partial view or neighbor set that is basically updated periodically, as many other protocols do. And basically, we just use this one to deal with faults. So when we detect faults in processes on the smaller neighbor set, we use the information in this second set to repair the first one. So the name actually means hybrid partial view, okay? So because we have two partial views that are managed with a hybrid strategy, okay? So just to summarize, the small active view, which is the one that we use for communication, has a size that is a log, but with a base 10, which is smaller than the natural logarithm, of the total number of processes plus C, and C is a small constant, usually one. We manage it reactively, so we only change things when you really need to, and this promotes stability, and minimizes the cost to reinforce the additional process, the additional property that we have, that are links in these neighbors are always symmetric. And there's a small cost to maintain this, okay, but it pays off. Since these links are symmetric, we actually use TCP to exchange information between those neighbors. And we also use TCP to detect failures. It's an unreliable failure detector. And then we use an additional passive view, which has basically k times the size of the active view that we update periodically. And I will explain how using a cyclic management strategy. And this is just for fault tolerance. And one thing that is important to understand is that this property of symmetric links provides something that most overlays actually lack, which is a node individually can control how many other nodes that are active in the system know him. Because the number of processes that you know about me are always exactly the same number of neighbors that I have, which in most overlays is not something that is guaranteed. And that's why this small property actually affects a lot the behavior of the system as a whole. So just to give you a very high level presentation of how this works, when a node wants to join the overlay, it has to know already someone that is part of the overlay, and it sends a join request to that node. That node will trigger the creation of multiple random walks that will go over the overlay that already exists. And these random walks will carry the identifier of the new node that is joining. They have a maximum lifetime, meaning that they will give a maximum number of jumps in the overlay until they end. And basically, we use these random walks to provide information to existing nodes about the joining node in different points of the random walk. So at different points, the new node will end up in the passive views of some processes already there and in the active views of some processes. You do need to reply back to the new node saying that you added him to the active view to enforce the symmetry, but that's a minimal cost. The nice thing about this is that whenever we broadcast the message, we are going to flood it. So that means that we are going to use all the TCP connections that we have in our active view, meaning that we are effectively testing all of our neighbors whenever we broadcast. And this is why we can use TCP as an unreliable failure detector. Whenever we detect that the neighbor in our active view is failed, has crashed, that we basically try to replace it as soon as possible with some neighbor that we have in our passive view. And we do that by asking that neighbor to add him to the active view, by having a simple exchange of messages to enforce the symmetry. So the only thing that is, the protocol is quite simple. So the last thing that you need to understand is how do you manage the passive view? And that's simple. So each node will periodically and independently start a random walk on the network, where it will send a shuffle message that carries identifiers of processes that that process has on, is active and passive views. Whenever that random walk terminates, the node where it terminates will reply back with a message containing a similar sample. And then both nodes will update their passive views with the information they received from their peer, but they will do so ensuring that there are a higher probability that correct nodes remain in the passive view. So some nodes will be expelled, some will be inserted, and we try to enforce that nodes that are more probable to be correct can be retained. And basically, this is the protocol. So the interesting thing is that, while the protocol is simple and the property that we are enforcing is quite basic almost, okay? When you compare the performance of doing a broadcast protocol on top of different overlays, and I'm here comparing with Scamp, Cyclone, and a special version of Cyclone that we did that would exchange acknowledgement messages to detect failures in a faster way. What we discovered is that the system becomes much more robust to faults. So in the x-axis, you have the fraction of processes that we failed simultaneously in the system. And in the y-axis, you have the fraction of nodes that are able to deliver messages being broadcasted at that time, okay? And what we see here is that when you use Hyperview, even if you have 70% of processes failing at the same time, you can still deliver the message to every surviving process. Other protocols start crumbling at 20-30% failures, okay? And the one that is, well, more robust other than Hyperview is the special version of Cyclone that uses these special acknowledgement messages to speed up detection of failures. So actually, the fact that you use a small partial view allows us to send less messages compared with the typical epidemic road test protocol, but it also allows us to focus on detecting the failures of that small subset of nodes and react fast when there's a failure. And so we avoid to miss the chance to deliver messages. And this was quite an interesting result that showed us that a simple strategy could actually yield very good results. So the takeaway from this hyperview work is that control, this technique, allows you to impose very minimal restrictions on the topology, but that these restrictions can have a really big impact on whatever it is that you're doing on top of the overlay. Okay? And this is a very interesting result, but we had to look for other alternatives, okay? So next, I'm going to speak to you about the bias technique and the XPLOT protocol. So Hyperview, as I said, showed that we could lower the communication cost of epidemic broadcast, since the log base 10 of N is lower than the natural logarithm of N, okay? And we could also ensure that we had very good fault tolerance properties, okay, compared with other alternatives. But the thing is that, in the end, the topology that you have on the active views of Hyperview is still random. And if it is random, it can be suboptimal. And this means that some links in the overlay might actually not be very adequate for whatever it is that you're doing. For instance, if you are broadcasting, you might want to have links, network links in your overlay that have high bandwidth or low latency. So actually, what we were trying to solve here with the bias technique was a very well-known problem called the network mismatch problem. Let me just introduce you briefly what this means, okay? And so again, imagine that you have this overlay network. And imagine that this first red node wants to send a message through the network to that second red node. In the network, they are just three hops away. So they just have to cross three overlay links to reach to each other. But if you think that the locations of the processes might be these ones, so both of the extreme nodes are in the USA, but the others are in Japan and Portugal, the communication pattern might be very inefficient, okay? And these sort of things happen a lot in completely random overlays, and this can actually introduce additional stress on the network infrastructure, and it will delay the communication between processes, if that is important in your use case. So a very simple way to solve this would be just to have that first node to disconnect from the Japan node and establish a new connection to the other node in the USA. And now your overlay just better, okay? You have a link that is faster, direct, and avoids to have a message going over the world to get to your neighbor, okay? So in principle, this is what XPLOT does. But actually, it's not just this simple, okay? So what we learned here is that biasing the overlay or switching links over time to improve the overlay, it's a nice idea, but you do have to do it with some care. And by the way, XBOT here means X bias the overlay topology, and X stands for a variable. Because what we learned also is that we could apply the same protocol to improve the overlay given any criteria, as long as you could attribute a cost to that criteria. So basically, we use a companion oracle in XBOT that allows a process to infer the cost for any neighbor or potential neighbor. And this could be like the latency for that neighbor, but it could be the throughput for a link to that neighbor, or could be a mix of these aspects of a link, okay? So basically the same technique can be employed for any different criteria that you can encode in a cost function. The other thing that we learned with XBOT is that optimizing the overlay links is great, but you should not overstress it, okay? So in particular, you should avoid to optimize some links such that you don't break the connectivity of the overlay. Usually if you lose connectivity, you lose everything. And what we do in XPLOT to solve this is that each node will never try to optimize its new neighbors that have the higher cost at each moment, okay? And what we learn actually is that it suffices for mu to be one for the system to be robust. Right, and avoid losing connectivity. So in this system, we assume that there is already a random overlay in place that can be managed by any protocol. In practice, for simplicity of presentation, I'm going to assume that is something similar to Hyperview that I just introduced. And so each node will have an active view, which is biased, will be biased by XPLOT, and some random passive view where it can get that it can use as a source for potential new neighbors. To promote stability of the system, we never allow a process to optimize the overlay locally if it doesn't have a full active view. So the primary goal of a process is to ensure connectivity, and only after that does it start optimizing the overlay. And finally, our Bayesian process is not that simple as just switching random links. We actually use a four-node coordination strategy where in each optimization step, we actually try to exchange two existing links by two new and better links. And let me show you with some animations how these work, okay? So basically, assume that we have these nodes. They are scattered to USA and Europe. And this green node will try to optimize the overlay. Here, I'm assuming that 3 is the target number of neighbors. In practice, this should not be so, but it's for simplicity. So we call this node initiator because it's trying to actively initiate a process to optimize the overlay. Assume that these nodes are these active neighbors, okay? The nodes that are in the active view, and that these are the costs for the links. So the links here are basically encoding the distance between the processes. So we keep these active views sorted in a decreasing order according to the cost. And as I said before, the link with the higher cost, we never touch it. So we'll never try to switch the link with process B from the perspective of the green node. We'll try to switch, however, the second worst link, which is in this case C. We call these nodes old. And then imagine that the red nodes are the nodes that are in the passive view of the green node. So we can pick one of them, measure the cost. And if the cost is lower than the cost to the old node, then you will try to switch the link with the old node for this red node in this case, which we'll call candidate. The candidate, if he has a full active view, might need to disconnect someone to be able to accept this exchange. And for that, he will pick the worst node that is not the one with the worst cost, okay, to protect the first one, that we'll call the disconnect, here represented in black. So as soon as you define what are the processes involved in an optimization round, the protocol itself is very simple. The initiator will check that the cost for the candidate is better than the cost to his old neighbor. If so, it will send an optimization to the candidate, providing the identifier for the old neighbor that he wants to replace. The candidate will pick up the neighbor that he will try to replace in this exchange and send a message to him, identifying both the old and the initiator nodes in the process. This disconnect process will make another validation that he will gain something by switching his connection to the candidate by a new connection with the node labeled old. And if so, it will send a message to this old node saying, switch your connection to the initiator by a connection with me. This process will verify local constraints, namely that it can do that replacement without violating other rules that we have in place. And if so, if everything checks out, it will just send a message back that will go back to the initiator saying, okay, we can do this exchange. And they will replace the links. So looking at the overlay, basically what we did is we replaced these two links between these two nodes, this pair of nodes, by two better links. Okay. And if every process does this in an independent fashion, starts these rounds, the overlay as a whole starts to improve without, however, losing the connectivity between these two extremes, which could happen if you were too aggressive. So again, it's a very simple protocol. And what we notice is that it was actually effective. So this plot shows the overlay cost, which is basically the sum of the cost of all overlay links in the active views of nodes over time as the protocols evolve. And we are comparing here with Tiemann, Ernol, and GoCast, which are protocols in the literature that do more or less, or at least have the same goal as XBlock. And actually, we are able to lower to the cost of the overlay when compared with Ernol and GoCast. This is not true for Tiemann, okay? And Tiemann is a very interesting protocol that actually is very aggressive. It allows a node to switch his entire neighbor set in a single exchange without any form of coordination. And this seems to be great here in this plot. However, the reality is that the overlays that are managed by Tiemann tend to break. And if you break the overlay again, you lose connectivity. Everything is lost at the same time. We also measured the effect of broadcasting messages using an epidemic broadcast protocol on top of these overlays. And again, what we notice is that using XBot, you can have latency as good as you can with TMAN, except that XBot is able to deliver the message to everyone. Well, TMAN, not really. And as you can see, the decrease in the latency of the system, in our case, is to lower than half of the latency if you didn't do anything, which would be that red point close to zero, the highest point. The other systems are also able to, the other solutions also are also able to improve the overlay, but not as much. Okay? So the takeaway here is that biasing the overlay allows you to specialize any random overlay to a particular aspect that you need in your system. This can be done with minimal coordination, but you do need some coordination. And you should avoid to use an aggressive strategy, otherwise you might lose other important properties of these overlays, namely the connectivity. So these are the key takeaways about this BIA technique. So finally, I'll speak about the embed technique and the plan tree protocol. So by this point,
sorry, João, David here, maybe before continuing, I just like have like this question in my head and maybe like before jumping into another. So like on this like technique for biasing the overlay, it seems like the finding a better pair of nodes to connect so that like we have like faster connections over the overall graph is a good strategy. But I'm just considering how would this be applied in a situation where some nodes are just like router nodes. So like it's not about just setting the faster connections between the router nodes, but actually figuring out how to set up the right routing tables for edge nodes to have the fastest paths between them. Like how would you keep that, like how would you get to that stable point without exploding in a number of messages necessary?
Okay. So actually, some people have explored that. They did so with TMAN. So as I said, TMAN is very aggressive, and this might be a downside of the protocol that we cannot ignore. So there's a protocol called T-Cord that is basically building cord using the TMAN optimization strategy. And you are touching on the really cornerstone of that solution, which is you can actually converge quickly to your desired topology. And I think that with XBot, you could also do that. The thing is that it's very hard for a node locally to know that it has already converged, and that it can trust its local routing table. And that's a big issue, because then if you are not sure you're converged, you might be doing incorrect decisions by accident. And that is quite of a big mess. We have looked into that problem in the past very quickly, okay? And we believe that there are some mechanisms that you can use to gather additional information so that you can have a notion of the stability of your routing table, your local routing table. But we still have to conduct additional research to solve that. Gotcha. And I actually get further ahead in my slides.
Gotcha. Okay, thank you. Thank you for the clarification and for the extra information.
It was a very good question. Thank you. Okay, so if there are no other questions, let's move to the embed technique and plan tree protocol. And as I was saying, by this point, I hope that you already think that epidemic broadcast is awesome, okay? And it really is, if that's what you need. It's highly efficient. You have nodes collaborating in the process. Each node might send a very low number of messages. That's nice. If your overlay is biased towards low latency links, it might be very fast also. It's quite robust. It can sustain the failure of many nodes. It can also sustain the loss of messages. And this is not really a surprise, because most glossy protocols, and in particular epidemic broadcast, is inherently redundant. And by redundant, I mean that there are multiple copies of the messages going over the network. Okay? And this is simultaneously the beauty and the beast of glossy. Because on one hand, the fact that you have redundant messages gives you all of these nice fault tolerance properties. On the other hand, if you are sending big messages or a lot of information, you are going to spend a lot of network resources. and also CPU, because processes will have to process and spend CPU time dealing with repeated messages. Just to understand that, okay, this message is repeated, I don't need to do anything. So at some point we started wondering, can we do better than what we already have, combining even Hyper-V and XBot, and not necessarily by design. So this diagram is a very simple overlay, okay? And the number that is in the nodes is the number of redundant messages that each process will get when you flood a message, like in Hyper-V, okay? I showed this before. I'm just now counting the total number of copies that each process gets. Some of them only get one copy, which is nice, but some also get three. So this also has the problem of creating imbalance between the processes, okay? The main intuition for Plumtree comes by looking at, in this case, to the links, the overlay links that were used to send a message that was not a redundant message. So if you look only at those links, and you for now ignore every other redundant link here, okay? Now if you rearrange a bit this graph, then you can notice that this is actually a tree, okay? So when you flood the network, or you do a epidemic broadcast, a classical algorithm where you pick fan out nodes, assuming that you get to every node, what you have in the end of the broadcast process, when you pick up the links that didn't result in some repeated message being transmitted, is a tree. And trees are nice. Trees are nice just because they allow you to send the minimal number of messages to reach everyone, okay? And this is actually the main intuition behind Plumtree. So the name stands for push, lazy push, multicast tree. And the push and lazy push are different gossip strategies that I will explain in a bit. But in a nutshell, the protocol is still an epidemic broadcast protocol. It operates as any other protocol. It picks T random neighbors from an overlay network, forwards a message to them. It's still fully decentralized. You don't need a central point of coordination to build the tree. The thing is that it takes into consideration if links are being used to convey new messages or repeated messages, to embed or to establish a secondary topology at the service level that is a tree, okay? And this secondary topology is on top of our random overlay that can be any overlay that I presented before or another one from the literature. What we do then is, after we have links marked as being part of the tree or not, we use different gossip strategies to convey information to those links. So the ones that belong to the tree use eager push. An eager push is basically when you have a message to send, you send the message right away. For the other links, we use lazy push, meaning that we just send an announcement saying that I have this message. And then if that node doesn't receive the message through some other path, it will ask me for that message. And again, I'm assuming a model similar to Plumtree, to Hyper-V, where TCP is used as an unreliable fault detector. And I'm also assuming that views are symmetric. So, as I said, the intuition is that we pick up the links that are used to generate a message lever and use that to build a tree. In our protocol, initially, or whenever a new link appears in random overlay, we consider that link as part of the tree, or at least a candidate to be part of the tree. When you broadcast a message, any link that is used to send a redundant message we'll have a message going back informing the process that, look, you are sending redundant messages here, don't. So we prune that link from the tree. And at the end of the first broadcast, you have a tree. If your broadcast is able to reach all the nodes, then that tree will cover all the nodes. And for that, if you're using flooding, as in Hyper-V, you just need to make sure that your original overlay is connected. So just to illustrate that, if you have this overlay and you start broadcasting a message, which I'm marking here with the red lines. You let the gossip process continue as any gossip protocol. Whenever you have redundant messages, you mark those links as being outside of the tree. You leave the process to continue up to the end and you get the tree. However, those links that are marked there in a dashed way, the ones where we use lazy push, are actually very important for the operation of the protocol. We just don't ignore those links. And why is that? Because now, if some process fails, if some node fails, then there's a risk that the significant part of the system will become disconnected from the tree. So we need to fix the tree at this point. But to do that, we need to detect that the tree has become broken because we don't have a central coordination point. And we do that actually by taking advantage of these lazy push announcements, okay? So whenever a process has a message to send, it will send the message to the three branches and it will send these announcements on the remaining links. When a node receives an announcement for a message that it has not yet received, it starts a timer. And basically, if this timer expires without the node receiving the message, this might indicate that the tree has broken. At that point, the node where the timer expired will ask the message to whoever sent in the announcement, and it will receive the message so that it doesn't lose the message. And as part of this asking process, we reintroduce that link between those two nodes to the tree. So basically, if there is a node failure and your tree breaks, several nodes might independently try to repair the tree. And in the end, you might get some redundant links again, which is not a problem because as soon as you broadcast another message, you'll identify the redundant links that you added to repair the tree and prune them, and you get again a tree. And this is a very simple protocol, as you can imagine. What we measured in our experiments, and if your overlay links are symmetric, as in Hyperview, you actually can share a single tree to allow every process to broadcast messages. And we also have some optimization that I'm not discussing here, that you can try to compact the tree to minimize its height. But what we discovered in our experiments is that the tree was successful. So if you account for the total number of redundant messages in the system when you broadcast a lot of messages over time, when using any variant of plenty with a single sender, multiple senders, optimized or not optimized, we always are able to retain a zero redundancy factor, whereas typical epidemic broadcast protocols, we have some factor of redundancy in our experiments equals three. So these are lots and lots of messages that we avoid transmitting without losing anything. And actually, when you look at the fault tolerance of the solution when compared with the eager broadcast protocol or the epidemic broadcast protocol that I discussed before, there's no really difference here. We don't lose anything by doing this. We are just sending some additional control messages as feedback for the messages that you get that are redundant. And in terms of fault tolerance, you are exactly at the same as if you were using a classical gossip protocol. So again, this was a very interesting result, okay? So the cost was minimal, but you get lots of things out of it. And these are the takeaways, okay? So for the plant tree protocol. The thing is that we can take advantage of the feedback provided by these peer-to-peer protocols that run on top of the overlays to manage the overlays themselves, okay? And this embed technique is actually nice because it's very simple to execute it and it has a very low overhead, but it has a lot of impact on the resources that you consume when you're doing something like broadcasting. And we can generalize this to other peer-to-peer services other than broadcasting, you know. So now that I discussed these three solutions and these three different techniques to manage peer-to-peer overlay topologies, you can ask yourselves, why is this so relevant? Okay, so peer-to-peer was the big deal on early 2000s. We are in 2020, okay? Why should we care? And in my opinion, there are several answers, okay? One of them is many of these solutions and the key ideas on these solutions were used in different contexts. For instance, PlantTree was used to support the metadata dissemination subsystem in the React distributed database, which is a cloud product, okay? So it's a peer-to-peer protocol moving into the cloud. If you look at Hyperview, the key ideas of Hyperview are underlying to the overlay that is used by Legion, which is a system that we built, that allows to do data replication among clients of web and mobile applications, okay? So you can have data being replicated in your client devices and synchronized directly between these clients, which allows your clients to have much faster access to data and to manipulate that data even if they're offline. And these are very different problems, but they could be tackled in part because we are using peer-to-peer technology. The other thing is that nowadays, we're moving towards the edge computing, okay? So cloud computing is evolving by exploring the use of resources that are already present in different locations under different administrative domains between their users, devices, and the cloud data centers. And this is important because the network links that ship traffic to cloud data centers will become eventually exhausted because we are producing more and more data at the edge. More than that, we need to get data processed and replies back in quick times, very fast. And if you need to ship lots of data to the cloud, have it processed there and then ship back to you, this might be too long. Imagine that you want to trigger a fire alarm. Okay? It might not be very useful if you trigger the alarm 2 hours after the fire starts because your data was being shipped to the cloud to some network link that was overloaded. So in the context of edge computing, if you really want to reap all of the benefits of edge computing and all of those devices that are already there and that we could maybe use to build new applications, you do have to consider that there are lots of things to manage. Okay, there are very different devices. You have to be able to track their existence. What is it that they can provide to you? Allocate computational tasks or storage tasks to these devices. And these might be very complex. Okay. And in this context, I believe, and some of my colleagues also believe, that overlay networks and gossip protocols can be very important to do that. Okay? And in fact, we recently have made some progress on this, and we are exploring how to use overlay networks and gossip protocols to do resource management in big scale edge computing. And this will be a paper that will appear soon in MCA, an international conference. So what about the future? Something that I ignored throughout this talk and that David already touched is that I started from the unstructured towards the structured, but are these techniques applicable to structured overlay networks or distributed hash tables? Okay. Can we maybe use similar ideas or adapt these techniques to be efficient there and allow us to improve the properties of these DHTs? The answer for me is that probably yes, and hopefully we are going to explore that in the near future in collaboration with Protocol Labs in the context of a RFP grant. Okay? So I hope that very soon we'll have new results that show that this is indeed possible and in practice we'll be able to show that. And as concluding remarks, so that you take some message to your home now if you don't got some part, okay? What I've been trying to say here is that peer-to-peer systems explored how to build scalable systems a long time ago, okay? And these lessons are still important nowadays, and they are relevant in other contexts. Overlay networks and gossip protocols are key components that were explored in peer-to-peer systems. And regarding these, the overlay topology matters. And it matters enough that we should look at it and try to improve and specialize these overlays for the purposes that we need for our own systems nowadays, okay? And I believe that these techniques will become, again, very relevant because the scale of our systems are increasing. So we'll need, again, to look into decentralized techniques and get away from big data centers to have our systems operating as we wish. And just allow me a few seconds to say that all of this work was not done in isolation. No man is an island. No work is done by a single guy in some hidden place, okay? There are lots of people that collaborated here, Luis Rodrigues, José Pereira, Robert Van Rines, Nuno Cavissa, Annette Dinuza, Maria Cecília Gomes, and Jordan West, and also my PhD students that are present in some of the papers that I referred throughout the talk, Albert van der Lind, Pedro Costa, and Pedro Fruto. And thank you. This was what I had to show you today.
Please, with the number of folks here, just type the word hand or question into the chat. That's the easiest way for me to monitor who wants to ask something. If you want to ask a question, but you don't want to be on the recording, which will be publicly posted, just type the question into the chat and I will read it on your behalf. So we'll go ahead and get started. David.
All right. Thank you, João and everyone. Thank you so much for joining today and like for giving this talk. Excellent overview of really, really inspiring work. We actually have read a bunch of these papers to for some of our protocol designs. And so some of these ideas here for the people of Protocol Labs might seem very similar to some things that we have been building and deploying. And with that note of like deploying, so like one of the challenges that we have been facing since the beginning of the project is like the typical peer-to-peer research is done in vitro, right? Like it's always like perfect network, perfect connectivity, no malicious actors. And so we always have to like play this game of like, okay, we need to create these network economics or reputation mechanisms or whatever needs to be in place in order to prevent malicious actors to use these mechanisms present in the network to abuse the network itself. And so with this XBOT and the ability to bias the network in a certain direction or another, was there any work done towards protecting the network from actors trying to bias the it in the wrong direction?
We didn't do that work directly, okay? So addressing malicious behavior in decentralized systems is quite complex, okay? But I have several answers to you. So in the particular case of XBOT, it's not really a big problem there, okay? Because the decisions that nodes take, they are sort of validated independently by each one with the partial view that he has of the optimization, okay? So in some sense, it's very hard for a single node to control the biasing process, except if it is proposing something that is good for that process, and in that case, it will accept. You might be able to use XBOT to isolate a good node surrounded by just malicious nodes, and that is quite bad, okay? But we didn't look into that, okay? That's actually very challenging. I have another answer, actually, which is recently in a VLDD paper, we looked into the model of Legion, which is also a peer-to-peer system, as I said, that allows clients to replicate fractions of an application state and synchronize directly. And we looked what were the attacks that malicious nodes could do to the replication protocol, and how could they defeat, for instance, causal consistency, which is a consistency that is sensible in this sort of big scale system. So we have shown that in that context, with enriching the system with some components that might not be completely centralized, we can actually do some things and avoid some of the attacks that malicious nodes would do. But there is still lots of work to be done in that context. I agree with that.
I really like the talk and the progression of techniques. So I guess we are familiar with sort of, we've had some of these ideas with you, some of these ideas, some variations of these ideas. I really like actually the notion of a passive and active networks. And I want to make a comment there. So the way I basically reason about this is you have an active network for sending broadcast payload messages, and you have a passive network for fixing broken links in the broadcast network. So the comment I want to ask, so that's a great, great idea. So two comments. The first one is that you say that both networks, you basically give the degrees of vertices in both of these networks using asymptotic notation. And you say, both in the passive and in the active network, I have log n messages, but in one case, they're k times more. So I'll tell you from my, so I come from a mathematical background. So I think you actually have a better result there, which is that you can have the random network, which is used to fix problems, you know, needs to be log n so that you can benefit from the resiliency properties that you mentioned you get from the epidemic literature. There's also results in math, which are this pretty standard sort of stuff. But the point that I wanted to make is that you actually don't need log n on the passive network, because the whole point is that the active network can fix these problems. So on the passive network, you can actually get away with all of one. And then, so I don't know if you know, why you wrote log of n, whether you've tested it or not, but at the end, then you talk about Plumtree, and I actually, I'm kind of wondering, because really the extreme of this idea is to basically have a Plumtree for a passive network. So just a tree that gets fixed every once in a while. And have Plumtrees for the active network.
Active, yeah.
And you know, I was wondering whether essentially you've tried this combination, but on the whole, it's a pretty nice progression of results.
That's actually basically what we do. Okay, so we just need that. There's a detail here. Okay, so we are not coordinating these neighboring relationships. Okay, overall. So you might have a given fixed number of neighbors that you picked at random, but in the end, your network might be broken in two pieces while everyone is ensuring that they have the right number of neighbors, okay? So our experiments, what we discovered is that when we use the log of total number of nodes, the overlay tends to be connected with a very high probability. Lower numbers tend to degenerate into disconnected clusters. So in the it's true what you're saying, that the passive view is actually what is giving us the connectivity, okay? And the K factor there is just because you are not checking if those nodes are active still, so you might end up having only failed nodes there. So to minimize that, you increase the size. But when you go to the active view, if you're not doing some extra coordination mechanism, you with a lower number of nodes, what our experiments show is that the active network might become broken.
Okay, I mean, so that's an interesting thing to understand why, because mathematically there is a simple theorem that says that if I have n vertices and each of them picks a constant number of random peers, then I will have a fully connected network. So
okay, random graphs.
Yeah. So that implies that the randomness, perhaps the quality of the randomness in the choices is not maybe as in theory.
And it's not. Yeah. It's not for sure uniformly at random. It's close, but not completely equivalent.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, this is all great, and it's a great sort of area to research. I just want to say one more thing quickly, which may sort of be a useful. It's something that we're looking into regarding the security of these kinds of things, and it may be a useful thing to consider for future research. But so the network of so the passive network that provides you with a random sample from the sort of set of members. So one question that I've been looking at is essentially, so this network, so what effect can Sibylls have on this network? So, and the effect is, and so the subtlety in this question is that if you have a bad actor, they can locally sort of bias choices of sort of in your random walk steps, but really the question is to figure out a quantitative analysis of basically how many bad actors and how much time relative to how frequently the good actors are sampling from the randomness network. How much time, basically it's a quantitative analysis of how much time it takes for how many bad actors to like completely sort of shift the randomness and basically destroy the topology of the active network.
That's a very interesting question. I never looked into it, but I guess that we can consider as soon as we use lots of times random walks because it's a nice way to sample something on the network, okay? Random walks, they tend to have a maximum number of hops that they can do. So you can probably compute the probability of a random walk to go over a malicious node, depending on the fraction of malicious nodes. And if it goes through that and you don't have any pairwise verification protocol, that the node does what it should with that message, it can probably deviate the protocol execution to some configuration that approximates some desire of the malicious node, okay? I agree with that. That's actually a very interesting question. I think that's a question that is worth to look more into detail, okay? I don't really have a direct answer. It's impossible, I guess, to get one now.
Yeah, yeah, not looking for an answer, just suggesting it. Sorry, let's give David some time.
Do you have time, Joao, for one very quick question?
Yes, a few more minutes. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, well, I'll maybe it's more like a prompt than necessarily a question because I skimmed the through your work during the weekend, and I noticed that you have some papers on privacy preserving primitives for cloud, like for search of like images in cloud storage. And and given like the constructions, it seemed to me that there is like some opportunity of like reusing those primitives for actually like content addressed file systems such as IPFS and so on. And so I wanted to just like probe you to see if you had like any thoughts or anything that you've been thinking or working on, because that's something that we are really interested in, is like figuring out how to provide privacy preserving primitives so that we can have like things like reader privacy on a peer-to-peer like a file system like IPFS?
I think there is some overlap, some warnings, okay? Some warnings and some interesting directions, okay? So the warning is that all of those works, the really touchstone is the index, okay? And computing the index tends to be hard to do in a decentralized fashion, okay? I would argue that if you compute small indexes in a distributed fashion that are completely independent, it should be fine, okay? But it will be hard to reason about the full content if you have that sort of distributed index, okay? This said, we also, some people here, I have not been involved in that as a primary force, okay? But some people here in my lab have also been looking into how to use these new CPU primitives, like SGX, to do this sort of computation in a way that you can trust the result. And in those cases, when you have additional guarantees, it might be easier to distribute the computation and build something that is consistent overall, okay? So I think there are some ideas there that can be applicable, but when we get to the distribution part, it becomes slightly harder, okay? But obviously, it's an interesting direction that should be pursued, okay? Thank you for the question.
Thank you, yeah. I think we are at time, right, Jonathan?
Yeah, we are. So, yeah, no, just to sign off, if you're watching on YouTube, please remember to like and subscribe and also share this video. This was a great talk. Also, we'd love to have you join our mailing list. You can do that in the footer at research.protocol.ai. Our next talk is Thursday, November 12th at 1800 UTC from Maria Apostolaki, a final year PhD student at ETH Zurich, advised by Professor Laurent von Weber. Her talk title is Routing Attacks on Cryptocurrencies. So thanks everyone for joining. It's been great to have you.